Good morning, everybody, and thanks for watching. So I'm going to continue in Ephesians chapter 1 here a little bit. And just want to reiterate from my last video that God's goal is creating sons, creating daughters, expanding his family in which Jesus Christ is the firstborn of what we will one day all be. Jesus Christ is the firstborn of God's endgame, of God's goal. That's Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is going to have many brethren because God's goal in creating humanity is to make them sons and daughters, to fill them up with all that he is. You know, as a good parent, anyone who has a son or a daughter and is a mother and a father to them wants to give that child everything that they have and more. Well, that's God's endgame. That's what he wants to do. He wants to give his children everything that he is. And he does it through the work of Christ Jesus. And he does it through an experience of evil so that his children will understand all that he is and have a greater joy and appreciation of all that he is because they went through a period of time separated from him from their perspective. But this is what God wants to do. This is his purpose in creating humanity. What's the meaning of life? Why did God do this? You know, all these philosophical questions, all these people who want to, I don't know what you call them, philosophers. What's that class that people take in college all the time? Philosophy. That's the only word I got. But it's answered here in Ephesians. That God created humanity for a purpose, and it's a glorious purpose. First, believers get this, then everybody else. And that's riddled across all of Paul's letters. But look at verses 6 through 9. Why does God do this? Why does God want to make sons and daughters? In accord with the delight, his delight, the delight of his will, for the laud of his glory, of his grace, which graces us in the Beloved, in whom we are having the deliverance through his blood, the forgiveness of offenses in accord with the riches of his grace, which he lavishes on us in all wisdom and prudence, making known to us the secret of his will, in accord with his delight. His delight. See, we're not performing for God here, like the Christians say. Like he's the great judge and we're trying to enter into what he is. He is lavishing this on us. It is his delight. He is giving it to us. He has pre-chosen us, believers, to have this first. Everybody eventually, 1 Corinthians 15, 21-28, is filled up with all that he is. But God's delight is to lavish it on believers first. It's not that believers earned it in any way. It's that God chose for them to have this first. His delight, which he purposed it in him to have an administration of the complement of the eras, to head up all in the Christ. All is head up in the Christ. Both that in the heavens and that on the earth, in whom our lot was cast also. So everything in the heavens and the earth will be head up in Christ. And both the heaven and the earth will have an administration. And now verse 11. In whom our lot was cast, also being designated beforehand according to the purpose of the one who is operating all in accord with the counsel of his will. One of the most clearest statements in all of Scripture saying that God does everything and nothing can happen outside of the counsel of his will. If he works out all things according to the counsel of his will, then how are things happening according to the religious person or the atheistic person? How are things happening that go directly opposite of God's will? That's not possible if everything is working according to the counsel of his will. So why do people, my question is, and I'm going to get off probably on free will here, but this is what this verse is saying. Why do people say that we have free will? Okay, I know that the scientific argument, like, oh, you feel like you make decisions and things like that. Of course, we do make decisions. Everybody makes decisions, but those decisions are caused by the greatest influence of our life, where we were born, who our parents are, our DNA, our mental framework, our inmost being, all sorts of circumstances that God has formed around us, invisible forces that we cannot see. All of that influences us, and it all works together. As we move through it, and us not knowing the future, and us experiencing the emotions of making decisions, we experience it in real time. But God is outside of time, and He sits. And got a great comment from Wes Fellenkamp. I think it was somewhere in Isaiah. He quoted a scripture that says that God tabernacles in the future, which means God is there in the past, He's here in the present, and He's in the future. He's eternal. There's no time constraints to God. So he is sitting right now in the all in all. He is seeing everyone complete. He's there. So everything exists in him. Acts chapter 17. In him we live and move and are. He gives us life and breath and all. But if we're, and he gives it to all. But if we're in him, if everything is held together and sustained by the life force, which Acts 17 says, then nothing, past, present, and future, can be outside of that eternal life force that is the source behind all things. So God is there. Not only did he plan the end from the beginning, but he's there in the end and the beginning. So it's impossible for anything to happen outside of God. But from a religious, biblical point of view, how people miss this is unreal. And I'm curious as to their argument. So if you say Adam and Eve didn't have free will, well, say you ask a Christian, where is free will in the Bible? Where does it talk about free will? Where does it say that God gave you a free will? Most, I think, would go to Adam and Eve. Okay, well, where in Genesis does it say that Adam and Eve were given a free will by God? They can look or they can do whatever. It's not there. But they'll say something like, oh, because they disobeyed God. Okay, so how does them disobeying God mean that they have a free will? Well, God told them not to eat of the fruit. And they did the opposite. They ate of the fruit. So that proves free will. So their reasoning for humans having a free will is because they disobeyed God. Well, what if we compare that with Romans chapter 9, which I've done in the past, but I'm going to do it here again because it's so clear cut. So, can we find an instance, if their reasoning for having a human free will, Adam and Eve, was because they disobeyed God, then can we find an example in Scripture where it was God's will for someone to disobey Him? Can we find that in Scripture? Well, of course we can. We can find that in Romans chapter 9. If you go through Romans chapter 9, it starts, and I'm not going to read all of it, goes through Jacob and Esau and how God has planned in verses 11 to 13 every detail of their life, good and bad, before they were even born. So before they were even born, before they came into existence, God planned everything out. And that included some deceit, some cheating, some evil actions to get birthrights and blessings, And yet that was the called out family that God called out to fulfill his purposes in the Old Testament. And then, if that's not enough, he says, consequently then, it is of him who is willing, not of him who is racing, but of God the merciful. So it doesn't matter if you're willing or racing, it's God that does everything. He causes you to will and to race and to do the things you want. Yeah, I have a will, I want to do this, I make the... Yeah, he causes you to want to make that decision. That's what it says here. But verse 17, for the same thing I rouse you up so that I should be displaying in you my power, and so that my name should be published in the entire earth. Consequently then, to whom he will, he is merciful, yet whom he will, he is hardening. And talking about Pharaoh here, how God hardened his heart. So God hardened his heart for Pharaoh to go against what God was saying he wanted him to do. So here it talks about there's a difference between God's stated will and his intention. People can go against God's stated will all the time. They can never go against his intention, what he actually wants them to do. So Pharaoh, you know, wouldn't let the people go. He wanted to let the people go. Moses came in, asked them, and finally Pharaoh was going to let him go. But God hardened his heart, purposely hardened his heart. But God told Moses that he wanted Pharaoh to let him go. Go ask him. Under the assumption that God wanted his people to go, which he did. But then he hardened his heart, Pharaoh's heart, to say no. So God's actually going against himself by hardening Pharaoh's heart. Because he wanted Pharaoh to let the people go. But then he purposely hardens his heart. So God causes it, and then Pharaoh, in Scripture in the Old Testament, says that he hardened his own heart, the Scripture says. But he's just hardened his own heart because God hardened his heart first. He's just reacting and making the choice that God caused him to make. But ultimately, it was God who hardened his heart. It says it right there in Scripture. So God is going against his own will to fulfill his intention. Why did he do that? To show Egypt and the world how great he was by sending the plagues, by splitting the sea and bringing Israel out of Egypt. He wouldn't have been able to do that if Pharaoh's heart wasn't hard. So even though he instructed and wanted, according to talking to Moses, and Pharaoh wanted Pharaoh to let the people go, that was his will. His intention was for Pharaoh not to let the people go, because God himself hardened his heart. So he went against God's will so that God can fulfill his intention of showing his power to Egypt and to the rest of the world and to Israel. And then Paul says he anticipates the question, the same question we get from Christians today. Well, then, if God chooses who will be good and bad, then how is he still blaming? And Paul doesn't even answer the question. He goes, but by not answering the question, he hammers the answer home. He says to that question, verse 19, you will be protesting to me then, why then is he still blaming? For who has withstood his intention? And Paul says, oh man, who are you to be sure who are answering again to God? That which is molded will not protest to the molder. Why do you make me thus? And he goes on to say that God can make vessels of honor and vessels of dishonor. But he doesn't even address the question, why is God still blaming? Because in his answer of saying, who are you to protest to God, the clay to the one who molded you, he is indirectly saying that of course he can do whatever he wants with you. Why is he still blaming? He can do whatever he wants. But that answers the question of free will. It's not even a debate. By moving on to the fact that he can do whatever he wants because he's God, he answers the fact that he does everything according to his intention. Everything God does is according to his intention, because Paul says, guess what? He's God, you're not. He can do it. So by saying that, he answers directly, or indirectly, I guess, but nails it home. The whole argument on free will, point blank, says that God does everything according to his intention, even though it might go against his will. What about the law of Moses? What was the law of Moses for? To show Israel that they could not reach God's standard and to introduce a Savior. That's why he called out Israel in the first place, so that he could move through these people and bring a Savior into the world that will redeem the entire world. And that was predicated on the fact that Israel would never accomplish the law. That's why they would turn to a Savior, which they rejected, but eventually they would accept sometime in the future, hopefully soon. But the whole law was God's will. He wanted you to follow the law, follow the Ten Commandments and the other commandments that were added by Israel. Follow them. That was his will. But his intention was for them not to follow it in order for them to learn that they could not reach God's standard of righteousness and to look for a Savior. So if you think God stated them and said, I want you to follow the law, if you think his intention was to follow the law, then you think that God never had a plan to bring a Savior into the world. Because the Savior coming into the world was predicated on the fact that Israel would not follow God's will, but do his intention of falling short of that standard of righteousness. So the whole argument that Adam and Eve disobeyed God in the garden means that they have free will is nonsense. You look at Revelation chapter 20. I'm going to go there. God, I'm not going to read it. God sends an angel to bind Satan for 1,000 years. Just one angel comes, scoops him up, and chains him up. So in the 1,000-year kingdom, he can't do anything. And then it says, at the end of the 1,000 years, they loose him for a while because they have to, because it's part of God's plan. So why didn't God do that in the garden? He could have. He could have took that serpent, chained him up. And then Adam and Eve would have had more of a free will because there wouldn't have been a serpent enticing them, deceiving them. How could they be free if you had a serpent in there, the adversary, deceiving them, making them believe something that wasn't true? But God didn't do that. He left them there in order to be the influence, so not free, to fulfill his intention, even though his will was don't eat of the tree. His intention was for them to eat of a tree so that we can go through this experience of evil, so we can understand God's love in sending his son to save us when we're at our worst, when we're sinners, when we're evil, when we're enemies, so that we can have that experience of being apart from God and through Christ's love and God's love being with God forever, so that he can accomplish Ephesians chapter 1, making sons and daughters and lavishing his love and his grace and his delight on us, having gone through the gauntlet of this experience in life in order to bring us to a deeper appreciation and maximize the joy that we will have when we're with them. But why do we go through evil? It's to maximize the joy that we're going to have when we're with God. Can you find in Scripture, I'm going to finish up here. I wanted to finish up a few other things, but I want to keep the video at about 20 minutes. So can we find an instance where God didn't want someone to do something, but it was actually his intention for them to do that? Well, if you look at Acts chapter 4, 27 to 28, I think God stated his stated will, maybe he never actually said this, but we can imply that his stated will would be that he didn't want human beings to murder his son. That he didn't want human beings to torture his son and kill them. You would think that that was wrong. You'd think that the scribes and the Pharisees and the Israelites and the Romans that were crucifying Jesus, you would think that that was wrong, that that went against God's will, which it did. They were doing something very wrong. All according to God, but they were doing it wrong. They were going against his will. But it was God's intention that they actually go against his will and do that, because that is what saved all humanity and what allows, or God's chosen method to allow him to do Ephesians chapter 1, to lavish all of his grace and delight on creation. So it's God's stated will, or implied will, that he wouldn't want these beings to murder his son. But in Acts chapter 4, 27 to 28, he says that those people, Herod and Pilate, the Israelites, the Gentiles, they did what God had planned according to his will. I'm going to go there because I want to read those words exactly, and then I'm going to close here. 27 and 28 of chapter 4. For of truth in this city were gathered against thy holy boy Jesus. Against thy holy boy Jesus. You would think it's God's will for these people not to murder his holy boy, whom thou dost anoint. That's God anointing Jesus. Both Herod and Pontius Pilate, together with the nations and the people of Israel, to do whatever thy, that's God's hand, thy hand and thy counsel designates beforehand to occur. So it's God's will that they didn't hurt his holy boy Jesus, but it was his intention that they do exactly that. It was his intention for them to go against his will in order to accomplish his ultimate goal. So the argument that we make choices, or Adam and Eve disobeyed God, has nothing to do with free will. Because God sets up his creation to go against his will all the time. But that's part of the plan. Nobody could ever go against his intention, what he wants them to do, what he has planned for them to do. If you disobey God, then it was God's plan for you to do that. If you obey God, it's God that put it in your heart to follow him and obey. I had a great question from a viewer. Okay, well then, if we know God does everything and you don't believe in eternal hell, then what's to say if the guy's listening around and he says, okay, there's no hell and God does everything, works everything out for good, then I can go harm children if I want. Because, the argument is that if people don't do bad things just because of the threat of eternal hell, then isn't that a good thing with regard to those people? Well, I'm going to talk about that a little bit in my next video, because Paul actually addresses that two times in his letter. And I'm going to talk about how Christians actually do believe that, because Christians act and don't act in ways because they're afraid of eternal hell. Remember, you take eternal hell away from Christians and they say, oh, well, I can go out and do whatever I want. I can murder children. I can rape little girls, rob banks. And that just reveals what's in your heart. So you're not doing anything out of love for Christ or out of grace. You're doing it to avoid eternal hell. All of that comes from a gross misunderstanding of who God is. And I said I was going to do that next video, and I'm starting it now. So I'm cutting myself off. And I'll see you next time. Thank you.